Hi, I'm Jordan from DisneylandForever.com, and I'm here to help you learn how to step into the magic. Hey guys, what's up? Now, we all know when you're planning a trip to Disneyland, you put in tons of effort and time to try and make it perfect. But there's still a few things that a lot of people, especially amateurs, just don't even realize that they need to know. So I'm gonna go over 5 things you need to know before you even leave on your trip. First thing you need to know is the refurbishment schedule. This refers to those regular routine closures of certain attractions at Disneyland. They happen all throughout the year. It's really hard to go sometimes when there isn't something closed down for refurbishment, but sometimes more things are closed than others, especially in the off season, like January through March. This is something you can actually look up online before you go so you can know ahead of time what is not going to be open while you're there. There's a few different places that you can find that. The first place that you could check is the main Disneyland website, Disneyland.com. They'll have everything listed, although it usually just has a daily play-by-play, and usually only 2, maybe 3 months in advance, and that can change drastically. There's lots of other websites you can check as well, including DisneylandForever.com, just saying. Now, if you find out that your favorite attraction is scheduled to be closed while you're gonna be there, there's some things that you can do. I mean, if it's possible, you can move your vacation up or down a couple of weeks, because most refurbishments only have the ride down for 1-2 weeks maximum. However, there are certain attractions that are down for an extended refurbishment. Now that could last anywhere from 1 to 3 months, sometimes longer. One time Space Mountain was closed for almost 2 years while they put in a completely new track. So it can take some time. You're gonna wanna look those things up so that you don't get there and get all really huffy and angry that your favorite ride is closed. Number 2 that you need to know, height requirements. A lot of major Disneyland attractions have height requirements, which means that not everyone is able to get on the ride if they're not tall enough. This only really applies if you're going with small kids, but let's be honest, most people do. And so there's certain things you need to be aware of so that you don't get really upset at the ride operator and the cast members when they tell you, I'm sorry, your child is too short to ride. Now the shortest height requirement is about 32 inches. So you know, that's around 2 feet, 8 inches tall. There's only a couple of rides that fit into that one. And those include the Autopia, and really I think that one, they're referring more to how tall you need to be to drive the car. And then there's also Mater's Junkyard Jamboree and Luigi's Rollickin' Roadsters over in California Adventure. There's one ride that requires 35 inches or taller, and that's Gadget's Go Coaster over in Toontown. It's a really fun ride, but if you're tall enough to go on Luigi's Rollickin' Roadsters, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're tall enough to go on Gadget's Go Coaster, so just be aware about that one. If we go just 1 inch taller at 36 inches, then you have Tuck and Roll's Drive-In Buggies over in A Bug's Land. They're kind of just bumper cars, but really fun. The most common height restriction actually comes in at 40 inches. That's about 3 foot 4 inches tall. So still not terribly short, but if your kid's maybe like less than 5, probably won't be able to ride it yet. And this one includes a lot of biggies. These ones include Big Thunder Mountain Railroad, Space Mountain, Radiator Springs Racers, Soarin' Over California, Splash Mountain, Star Tours, the Tower of Terror. Also other rides such as Jumpin' Jellyfish at Paradise Pier, Silly Symphony Swings, things like that. They're all gonna require 40 inches or taller for them to be able to get on. Next comes 42 inches. With this one you've got Goofy Sky School, the Matterhorn, and Grizzly River Run. There's also one ride that requires 46 inches or taller, and that's Indiana Jones. The Indiana Jones Adventure does require that it's a little bit taller. The tallest height restriction is 48 inches, that's 4 feet tall. And that one is for California Screamin', you know, the biggest roller coaster that Disneyland has. The main reason I tell you this is because it's important before you go that you have your kids measured before you get to the park. That way, you already will have an idea of what they may or may not be able to ride. Now, don't be worried if you feel that you may have gotten it wrong, or you just don't feel you have the time to be able to measure them all before you go, it's okay, because at every ride, there are cast members next to a little measuring thing. They look different for every person. I don't know why I'm putting it up here, there's no way they're gonna be this tall. You get the idea. When you get to the entrance of the ride, you can go up and even ask the cast member, is it okay if I measure my kid really fast? They'll say, oh, sure, go for it. And then you can just check and see if their head hits at least the top of the bar, then they're tall enough to go. If they're just barely tall enough, be aware every cast member is gonna ask to measure them. It's not because they don't trust you. They're just doing their job. So just let them do it, it'll all be good. Another thing you need to be aware of with the height requirements, if you're going with enough adults, or enough kids that are tall enough to go, and maybe there's just a few that are too short, Disney offers something called rider switch on many attractions. I'll make another video that talks about that and some other things that you may want to be aware of as parents. Number three. Now, there are some attractions that have other restrictions attached to them that you need to be aware of. Something other than height. For example, wheelchairs. If you are in a wheelchair or require a wheelchair for any reason, there are certain attractions that will actually allow you to stay in your wheelchair. Those ones are usually like in a theater. Maybe they're a little bit more like a show type of attraction and not so much one that moves. So things like, you know, Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln or the Enchanted Tiki Room. Those ones, they just permit you to stay in whatever wheelchair you've got. There are some, though, that will require you to either move from an electric wheelchair into a standard, you know, hand-powered wheelchair. Those are things like It's a Small World or Buzz Lightyear Astro Blasters. And then there are still others that will require you, obviously, to transfer from your wheelchair. Doesn't mean you have to walk a lot, you just have to be able to move from your wheelchair into the ride vehicle, such as Space Mountain or Thunder Mountain, or most of the biggies. For a lot of other attractions, especially the big, more intense ones, they have what's called a health advisory. The health advisory pretty much just says that if you have any major issues, like intense neck, back, or heart problems, have high blood pressure, or maybe just have intense motion sickness, that this may not be the right for you. They're doing this for your own safety. Now, this does not mean that they're gonna stop you at the entrance of the attraction and ask to see a doctor's note that says that you're permitted to ride. No, it's up to you. You're just being honest with yourself. But oftentimes, it's in your best interest to just follow what the restrictions say. Don't put yourself in jeopardy and make yourself sick because you wanted to ride the teacups, okay? To go along with that health advisory, they also have what's called the expectant mother's advisory. It pretty much goes along with the same attractions. It's just letting you expectant mothers out there know that these attractions also might be just a little bit too intense for someone who's expecting. Number four. Now, this is something that a lot of people don't even think about doing unless they're like Disney pros. For example, I do it all the time. That is dining reservations. Did you know that a lot of the restaurants in Disneyland allow you to make reservations? You don't just have to show up and hope that they're gonna have a table, you can get one ready for you. They even take reservations up to 60 days in advance. You can make those online at disneyland.com. What's nice is that they will send you a reminder email about your reservation just a couple of days before you're supposed to show up. So just in case you forgot, or you're worried that you're gonna show up at the wrong time, there's something there to help you. I definitely recommend making dining reservations just because it's something you don't have to worry about. You will already know certain places you're gonna be able to eat. You don't have to like walk around wondering, oh crap, where's there not gonna be a line, everybody? I don't know, everyone's really busy. You don't have to go through all that. You're on top of things. Number five. Plan out what entertainment you're gonna want to see. There's a lot of shows and parades and nighttime spectaculars that are awesome at Disneyland, but there are usually too many to fit in all of them. No matter how long you're gonna be there, you're usually not gonna have time for everything. Go onto either Disneyland.com or other places that kind of list out some of the shows that they have, maybe like DisneylandForever.com, I don't know, and get an idea of some shows that you know you're definitely gonna wanna see. And for certain shows, like World of Color, for instance, you have to get a fast pass if you wanna get a really good seat for it. So this is something you're gonna wanna be aware of. If you plan everything out like that ahead of time, then what that allows you to do is add in some of the other shows that seem really good, but like, well, maybe if we have time, you can throw those in when suddenly you find you have some time. And besides, Disneyland isn't just about the attractions. The shows are equally entertaining and just as amazing to watch. So there you go. Those are five things that you can know ahead of time before you even leave on your trip to Disneyland that's gonna make a huge difference so that you're not gonna be so angry and tired and really confused the whole trip. All right, guys, thanks for watching. For more videos just like this one, make sure you subscribe and you can also follow us on Facebook. Make sure you check us out at DisneylandForever.com. See ya.